Hello, my dear students. Welcome back to my channel. Today, in this video, we are going to learn class 9 English chapter, that is the Storyteller, and we'll see part 1 of this chapter. It's written by H.H. Munro. So, let us start the story. But before that, students, if you are viewing my video for the first time, do subscribe my channel and hit the bell icon so that you get the notifications of all the upcoming videos. And do watch the video till end. And if you like it, hit the like button and share with your friends too. So moving on to the story and the author, we'll see about H.H. Munro. His full name is Hector Hugh Munro. He was born on 1870 and he died in the year 1916. He was better known by the pen name Sucky. His pen name or the nickname you can say was Sucky, and he was frequently called as H.H. Munro. He was a British writer whose witty, mischievous, and sometimes macabre stories satirized Edwardian society and culture. Okay, so he used to write the humorous story. He was mischievous, and he was sometimes it would be witty, and sometimes it would be macabre stories. Now, macabre are the stories which has lot of blood and death in the story. So that kind of story he started to write, and he was considered as a master of short story. And he was also compared to the other authors like O. Henry and Dorothy Parker. So he has done a very good work in the field of literature. And one of the lessons from his writing is here today. So let us see what we have to read in this chapter. So this is a kind of short story. So let us see. He says that it was a hot afternoon and the railway carriage was correspondingly sultry, and the next stop was at Temple Combe near the R ahead. The occupants of the carriage were a small girl and a smaller girl and a small boy. An aunt belonging to the children occupied one corner seat, and the further corner seat on the opposite side was occupied by a bachelor who was a stranger to their party, but the small girls and the small boy empathetically occupied the compartment. Okay, so here he says that he describes the scene that it was in a hot afternoon and he was just traveling. It was a railway carriage where many people were as the passengers there, and the next stop was at Temple Combe, a place. Okay, and it was nearly an hour ahead. Like after an hour, that stop would come. And the passengers who were there in that carriage, in that compartment, were a small girl and more smaller girl and a boy. And an aunt who was taking care of the children along with these children were a aunt was an aunt who was sitting at the corner of the seat. And there was one more corner, the next side, opposite side, which was occupied a bachelor, and he was a stranger to their party. That means he did not belong to that group, but he was a passenger and he was traveling in the same compartment. But these small children, small girls and small boy, they occupied the whole compartment. They were running here and there, making lots of noises, disturbing all the passengers, and this is how they occupied the whole compartment. Now, both the aunt and the children were conversational in a limited, persistent way, reminding one of the tensions of a housefly that refuses to be discouraged. Now, this aunt, she did not talk much to the children because they were busy in their own world, in their own talks and in their own mischievousness. But this aunt's voice and this children who were just going on saying some other thing, it reminded as if some housefly which is flying in and around you, but it's not moving away. It is refusing, and we cannot discourage it. We cannot make it go out from the place also. And we have to just sit without bothering. So in the same way, this children and aunt was bothering the stranger and other passengers who were traveling in the compartment. Now, most of the aunt's remarks seem to begin with "do not." And nearly all the children's remarks begin with "why." The bachelor said nothing loud. Now, aunt was just saying the children again and again as a reminder, do not climb there, do not shout, do not make noise, all such kind of thing. And in return, children used to respond as, why should we not make noise? Why should we not go there? Why should we not do this and that? All sorts of things. So this was heard by bachelor and other passengers, and they said nothing but just sat across there, and they were just feeling irritated there. Now, do not Cyril, do not, exclaimed the aunt, as a small boy began smacking the cushions of the seat, producing a cloud of dust at each blow. Come and look out of the window, she added. Now, the small children, they were so mischievous that they were not sitting at all. Among that, one small boy's name was Cyril, and aunt is trying to make him stop from doing something. She's saying, "Do not, Cyril, do not." What was he doing? He was smacking the cushions of the seat. Once he was punching the cushions of the seat of the train, and that was in return was blowing a cloud of dust, and it was mixing in the atmosphere in the air, and it was making the atmosphere dirty. So aunt was making him not to do that, so she just stopped. She was trying to stop him, and so she called, "Come and look out of the window, something is there for you." The child reluctantly moved to the window. "Why are those sheep being driven out of that field?" he asked. So now, though the child at the side, he did not want it to come to the aunt towards the window, but even then, because the aunt kept on calling him again and again, he had to come there. And then she showed them the sheep which were in walking or driven away in that field, and as if it was something new for the child to see, she called him to see that. So there was a question arose by a child. He said, "Why are those sheep being driven out of that field? What is the reason?" "I expect they are being driven to another field where there is more grass," said the aunt quickly. Now, because the child has arisen the question, the aunt had to answer something. She says, assuming to give an answer, and she says that, "I think that they are being driven to another field because there will be more grass than how much it's here." You know, when you say something to the children, they have lots of questions and queries, and you need to give the explanations to their questions or else they'll not keep quiet. And this was the problem here, which the aunt was facing with these children. So she somehow gave the answer for this. And then again, the boy said, "But there is lots of grass in that field," protested the boy. "There's nothing else but grass there." "Aunt, there is lots of grass in that field." So the child again is having one more question. You know, when you say something, the children, they have many questions behind one and the other. You need to answer and explain and make them understand, or else they're not going to keep quiet. So the boy quickly asked, "But here I can see lots of grass. So there's nothing else but grass and grass and grass in that field." So she says, "Perhaps the grass in the other field is better," suggested the aunt fortuitously. Now again, the aunt had to give the answer. She said, "Maybe in the other field, the grass is better than this. That's why." So again, the question from the child, "Why is it better?" came the swift, inevitable question. So aunt, in order to give the answer, she was not knowing what she should say. So let's see what answer she gives. "Oh, look at those cows," exclaimed the aunt. Nearly every field along the line had contained cows or bullocks, but she spoke as though she were drawing attention to a rarity. Now here, when she did not know what answer should she give for why the grasses are better in other fields, she tried to divert the question, and she's saying the child that, "Look at that cows there, and there were cows in almost every field, and they were standing in rows, so that was nothing new, it was common." But in order to just divert the child's mind, she is trying to draw his attention as if something rare and unique she is showing to him. "Then why is the grass in the other field better?" persisted Cyril. Now this boy, he was not going to keep quiet and listen until he gets the answer. Again, he arises the same question. "Why is the grass in the other field better? Come on, give me the answer." So the frown on the bachelor's face was deepening to a scowl. He was a hard, unsympathetic man. The aunt decided in her mind, she was utterly unable to come to any satisfactory decision about the grass in the other field. Now, poor lady, this aunt, she was already very much like finding the answers, trying to give a suitable answer, but she was not able to do that. And all this conversation was heard by the bachelor, who was sitting up the opposite side, and he had a frown on his face. Means he was getting irritated by this noise and these questions and this story. And he heard it, but he did not say anything. Aunt was understanding that he is not feeling good, but even she couldn't help there. And she was trying to come up with satisfactory answer, but she failed. She was not able to give why the grass in the other field is better. Then the smaller girl created a diversion. Means even she started saying something, and that was by beginning to recite on the road to Mandalay. She only knew the first line, but she put her limited knowledge to the fullest possible use. She repeated the line over and over again in a dreamy but resolute and very audible voice. So you might have heard that small children, when they're going to school or nursery classes, if they learn something in some poetries or some rhymes in the school, they keep on reciting that again and again. Even if they forget everything and just one or two lines, you know, they keep on repeating that. So the same thing happened here with this girl. She started reciting a line, on the road to Mandalay, on the road to Mandalay, on the road to Mandalay. And she kept on saying that. She kept on reciting because she remembered only one line, this first line. So she repeated and repeated again and again, and very audible voice, loudly she used to say. And it seemed to the bachelor as though someone had a bet with her that she could not repeat the line aloud 2,000 times without stopping. And this stranger who was sitting the bachelor, he just started thinking that as if this girl, she hadn't bet with somebody that she could not repeat the line at least 2,000 times without stopping. That was the type of repetition she was going on and on again and again and without stopping in an audible voice. So he was just singing as if she has got a bet and she couldn't repeat, and she's competing with that. She wants to fulfill that bet. And he says that whoever it was who had made this wager was likely to lose his bet. And he was damn sure that whoever has made this bet is going to lose, because this girl is repeating and repeating and she is going to finish it 2,000 times without stopping. You could just imagine what would be the condition of that stranger now. "Come over here and listen to a story," said the aunt, when the bachelor had looked twice at her, at once at the communication cord. So now here, aunt, in order to divert the mind of the children, she called them here towards her. She said, "Come here, I'll tell you a story. Listen to a story." She said this when she saw that bachelor is not feeling comfortable. He's getting disturbed and irritated. And twice bachelor had seen towards the aunt because of this communication it was going on. So she thought, "I would call the children towards my side and I would say some story to them so that they could sit quietly." And then the children moved listlessly towards the aunt's end of the carriage. They came and sat towards the aunt. Evidently, her reputation as a storyteller did not rank high in their estimation. Means that the children did not like the story which was told by aunt. Now, as a storyteller, she did not rank high. Okay, then. In a low, confidential voice, interrupted at frequent intervals by loud, petulant questioning from her listeners, she began an enterprising and deplorably uninteresting story about a girl who was good and made friends with everyone on account of her goodness, and was finally saved by a mad bull by a number of rescuers who admired her moral character. So this was her story. The aunt, she was not so good in storytelling, but so in the low confidential voice, she started saying the story. And in between, she had a loud intervals of questioning from her listeners. Like children used to ask questions every now and then, and they used to interrupt in between. Now she began that story about a little girl who was very good in her character, had many friends because of her goodness, and once she was saved from a mad bull because there were a number of rescuers who came to help her because she had a good moral character. So such kind of stories they said, and it was not satisfactory. It was not liked by the children. "Wouldn't they have saved her if she had not been good?" demanded the bigger of small girls. So there the question again arises from the listeners, from the children. One of them asked that, "Wouldn't this, they would have saved her if she wouldn't have been a good girl?" Because she said, because of goodness, people had come to save her. So this question arises now. It was exactly the question that the bachelor had wanted to ask. Okay, when bachelor had the same question. "Well, yes," admitted the aunt lamely, "but I don't think they would have run quite so fast to help her if they had not liked her so much." So after thinking, the aunt gave the answer that, "Yeah, but I don't think they would have been very quick in helping her if she would not be good, or she would not be liked by so many people. They would have not come so quickly to help her." So this was the answer given by the aunt. "Now, it is the stupidest story I have ever heard, said the bigger of small girls with immense conviction, means she did not at all like the story. "I did not listen after the first bit. It was so stupid," said Cyril. The smaller girl made no actual comment on the story, but she had long ago recommenced a murmured repetition of a favorite line. So all the three children, they did not like the story. They had one or the other reason, and poor aunt, she was a failure as a storyteller. "You don't seem to be a success as a storyteller," said the bachelor suddenly from his corner. Now to this, storyteller interrupted and he said, "You are not a successful storyteller." Now the aunt, in instant of defense at this unexpected attack, "It's a very difficult thing to tell stories that children can both understand and appreciate," said stiffly. Now aunt, to counterattack him or to give the answer for her defense, she said that this was a difficult task. Telling the stories to children is very difficult because they should understand and appreciate both. So she said this. "I don't agree with you," said the bachelor. The bachelor said, "No, I don't agree with you. This is not the fact. So perhaps you would like to tell them a story?" Aunt retorted, asked the stranger, the passenger there. "Tell us a story," demanded the bigger of small girls. Now they started demanding to this bachelor to tell us the story. The children demanded it. So he started. "Once upon a time," began the bachelor, "there was a little girl called Bertha, who was extraordinarily good." Okay, so story begins like this. The stranger is saying, children's momentary aroused interest began at once to flicker. All stories seemed dreadfully alike, no matter who told them. Like at the beginning, they did not like, they thought all the stories are same. Whoever says the story remains the same, they thought. Then she did all that she was told. She was always truthful. She kept her clothes clean, ate milk puddings as though they were jam tarts, learned her lessons perfectly, and was polite in her manners. So he started describing that good girl, what features she had, how she kept herself, how she was polite and everything. Then the question arises here. See, the children, they never leave you. When you say a story, they have many questions. They ask the question, "Was she pretty?" So he says, "No, not as pretty as any one of you," said the bachelor, "but she was horribly good." Like, she was not good to look at, she was not so pretty, but she was good in character. This is the way he answered. Now there was a wave of reaction in favor of the story. The word horrible in connection with the goodness was novelty that commended itself. It seemed to introduce a ring of truth that was absent from the aunt's tale of infant life. So here when he said yes, horribly she was good, means very much goodness in her character. So there's brought a change in the story of the strangers as of from the aunt. So now children got the attention, or they got fascinated towards the story, and they started listening with great interest. So again they had questions. "She was so good," and continued the bachelor. So now bachelor is continuing. "She was so good that she won several medals for goodness, which she always wore pinned on her dress." He's saying the story. "There was a medal for obedience, another medal for punctuality, and a third for good behavior." So this, she had won all these three medals for different characters that she had. And they were large metal medals, and they just clinked against one another as she walked. So she used to wear these medals whenever she went out, and this clinked against one another when she walked, and it made the sound. And no other child in the town where she lived had as many as three medals. So everybody knew that she must be an extra good child. So whenever she went out, she walked on the road, and all the other children in the town, they just used to admire her. And they knew that she is an extraordinary child, extra good child, because no child in that town had these three medals. Okay, so let's see whether the story goes on. Is it liked by the children or not? In our next part of the video. Till then, just keep guessing what would be the story. Would the bachelor be successful as a storyteller? Will children appreciate him? We'll see all these things in the next video. So I hope you have understood till here. If you like the video, do hit the like button and keep watching my videos. We'll be back soon with part 2 of this chapter. Till then, take care and thank you.